we're going to look at forgiving ourselves. That's where we need to start, always in forgiveness, is forgiving ourselves first. And through forgiving ourselves, hopefully we'll learn how to forgive others as well. Let's look at a few highlights before moving ahead. We're on this morning workshop.
Now you're on.
That's the beginning of our video, but we're not ready for that yet.
No, we got to stop it here.
It's all right. So that's where that grace comes in. Thank you for doing that. You were right on cue. Because I am asking our tech folks to do something that they're not as comfortable with, not as familiar with. So we're going to have extended grace through this time. So that was wonderful. let's look at some things for this week. This coming Tuesday is the free community meal at St. Louis. They start serving at 4:30. There will be four different kinds of soup. So if you know of somebody or you yourself need a warm, nutritious meal, get yourself over there and get a wonderful soup supper. On Friday of this week is the rescheduled fifth quarter from a couple of weeks ago, and we still need help with different things and food donations, so that sign-up list is out in the gathering area. Please go look at that after worship today and find a way where you can help out with fifth quarter. It's one of the most wonderful things that we're doing, to see the hall filled with, you know, 40, 50, 60 kids and a few adults is just a wonderful thing. So be a part of it. And then look at the rest of the announcements for yourself on the bulletin. With that, I'll ask Lindsay to lead us once again.
Please stand as you're able for the call to worship. Return to the Lord our God.
For God is gracious.
Confess to the Lord your God.
For God is merciful.
Repent to the Lord your God.
For God is slow to anger.
Praise the Lord your God.
For God abounds in steadfast love.
Worship the Lord your God.
Together let us worship God.
Oh,
are seated or standing or watching online, I pray you will join your heart with mine this day in prayer. My Lord, how we do need you. We need you in our personal lives. We need you in the lives of our families. We need you in the life of the church family and friends. Our communities need you. Our state and nation need you. And oh my goodness, how the world needs you. You and you alone. You are everything that we need. So as we learn, help us to turn faster towards you, to turn around, to get back on the path, to come to you with every need, as you have told us is our responsibility and our joy to do. And it starts now. It starts with each of us. We pray this in the name of our Holy One, Jesus our Christ, and all God's people said.
Amen.
Please be seated. And then continue looking at the prayer needs of the church. You have that written list on the back of your bulletin. I missed an announcement this morning. There will be handbell practice next Sunday after church, so we'll get that into the bulletin as well. But if you're one of the dinglings, then you know that you're being called to come and practice next week. Ginger Vetter's open heart surgery has been successful. She's ahead of schedule on the recovery line, and we give God the praise and continue to ask for continuing prayers for her and for all these others. Ginger is now recuperating up north, but she will be coming home probably sooner than expected. So just continue to keep her in your prayers. We know that Bob Edgar is getting ready for his upcoming surgery, so begin to pray for that. Randy Rohn had a pacemaker with a defibrillator put in this week, and that seemed to be going well. And there's a praise of Sharon Howie's granddaughter, Kayla, is doing pretty well. We still need prayers for all of these folks and for so many others, but your prayers are powerful and they are making a difference in many people's lives, so continue to pray. These next 4 weeks at least, I'm going to lead you in what is called a visualized prayer. It's another resource, another tool that I want to encourage you to use. It's a tool that I use when I'm under great stress, like at the dentist office. A doctor can do anything they want to me, but the dentist is a different thing. So visualized prayers are just a time when we close our eyes and enter into prayer in a kind of more like a story form. And hopefully you'll all be able to relate to some of these visualized prayers. So I'm going to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes for just a few minutes as I lead you in a visualized prayer. As usual, I'm running late. When I get to the parking lot of the store, and I need to get this task done as quickly as possible. But as I enter the parking lot, there doesn't seem to be any spaces at the front nearest the door. I just want to scoot in. I just want to scoot in and scoot out. I'm late. I need to get this done. And then, as I'm praying for you to open up a parking space, lo and behold, somebody's reverse lights pop on. I see my chance. important. And the thing I need to get done is more important in my mind at that moment than the other person waiting in the car. So as soon as the car that's in reverse pulls out, I begin to pull in, knowing full well that the other driver has been waiting patiently too. But in that moment, I don't care. It's all about me. It's all about the things that I need to accomplish. So I pull in first. I glance at the other car. I get a glimpse of the other driver. They have a bit of scowl on their face. And I kind of chuckle a little bit. I beat you. I got it. You didn't. But then I look again. And I realize that it's just a little old man. But I won. As I get out of the car to scoot into the store, I see that the other car and driver is finally found another space farther away. And you encourage me to stop and look just for a few more seconds, Lord. And you notice that the little old man has to use a cane in the parking lot. And that the space closest to the door would have served his needs so much more better than my own. You're speaking to me, Lord. You're telling me that the things that I need to get done will get done, but that I shouldn't have neglected the needs of another. So you speak to me once again and you say, you're not so much in a hurry. Maybe you need to go speak to that person. Maybe you need to make an apology. Maybe you need to just fess up and say that you realized that you pulled in front of him and that you're sorry. I'm still in such a hurry, Lord. My task is still in front of me. And the Lord speaks again and says, no, your task will get done. It will be all okay. But just maybe you need to take these few more seconds to walk to that person and to say those three words, I am. Your forgiveness, Lord, comes in all places, in all times. So we ask you to continue speaking to us. Let us hear you. Let us know that everything we do is meant to glorify you, and that when we're not obedient, and when we're not compassionate and caring, that we are not reflecting you. Help us, Lord, in the days ahead, to remind ourselves that we are created in your image, each of us. And that our purpose is to reflect you, so that whether others know you or not, they will see you in the things that we say and do. Let it be so, Lord. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Let's sing, Jesus Loves Me, as the kids come forward today. Thank you. brought yours too. Good for you. It's something that we all need to be doing. Even the adults should be bringing their favorite translation of the Bible to church with them. We don't push that enough, but it's what we should be doing. And I'm so glad to see all of you this morning. In fact, I'm wondering, what is it that I'm missing that has called all of you here to church today? Because guess what? You haven't been here. There's been weeks and weeks and weeks where we haven't been in church. So you know what I'm thinking. I think I know why you're here. And it's an okay reason to be here, but probably not the best reason. Are you here because you're going to have brunch after church today? No? Greg is this one. You know, when I was a child, and even still today, in some of the yards where I am, there's little wild daisies. Do you have wild daisies in your yard? Little white flower with a yellow center. Yeah, just little white flowers with a yellow center. And usually those are like little wild daisies, or you can get a daisy at the grocery store at the florist too. Now this is an artificial daisy, so we can't really do it. But when I was a kid, you would take a daisy and you would pull the petals off. And every time you pull the petal off, you'd say, "He loves me." Oops. A little too hard. And then you would pull the next petal and you would say, "He loves me not." And then you'd pull the next one and you'd say, "He loves me." And then you'd pull the next one and say, "He loves me not." Until there were no more blossoms left. You would just keep going right around the daisy to do that. But we've got good news today, because if we're doing that with a daisy or thinking about God, we're going to pull a petal and say, "He loves me." And then we're going to pull the next petal and we're going to say, "He loves me." And then we're going to pull the next petal and say, "He loves me." Because God loves each of us so very, very much. I hope you know that, and yeah, some of you do know that. And we love you, and we love you when you're here, and we love you when you're not here. We miss you when you're not here, and we can't share a lesson with you when you're not here. So I hope that in the weeks to come, that you'll begin coming back again more regularly, more often. But whether you're here or not, I do hope that every day you remember that God loves you more than you can even imagine. God loves each of us more than we can even imagine. He loves us so much that he sent his only son to teach us, to live with us, to show us a new way of living and a sacrificial way of living for each of us. God's blessings. I have a bulletin for you this morning. I don't have a bag. So as you go off for junior church, remember that you are missed and that you are loved. Let's sing again, "Jesus Loves Me," as the kids come. Join me in your United Methodist hymnal on page 824 for Psalm 103. capital red letter R, so several times during this, I'll read you in the normal face print and ask you to respond in the bold face print. So let's start with that response. As far as the east is from the west, so far the Lord removes our sins from us. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless God's holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all God's benefits.
Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed by the eagles.
As far as the east is from the west, so far the Lord removes our sins from us. The Lord who works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed has made known God's ways to Moses, God's acts to the people of Israel.
The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
The Lord will not always chide, nor harbor anger forever.
The Lord does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities.
For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is the Lord's steadfast love towards the faithful.
As far as the east is from the west, so far does the Lord remove our transgressions from us.
As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to the faithful.
For the Lord knows our frame and remembers the end of our dust. As far as the east is from the west, so far the Lord removes our sins from us.
As for mortals, their days are like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field, for the wind passes over it and it is gone, and its place knows it no more.
But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on the faithful, and the righteousness of the Lord to the children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. As far as the east is from the west, so far the Lord removes our sins.
Grace, grace, grace is the Lord in glory.
yourself lucky, how happy you must be to get a fresh start, your slate's wiped clean. Count yourself lucky, God holds nothing against you, and you're holding nothing back from him. When I kept it all inside, my bones turned to powder. My words became day-long groans. The pressure never let up. All the juices of my life dried up. Then I let it all out. I said, I'll come clean about my feelings to God. Suddenly, the pressure was gone. My guilt dissolved. My sin disappeared. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
As Edith is pulling up our video this morning, I'm going to ask you to think of something you personally need to ask forgiveness for from the Lord, because it starts with us. It always starts with us. So think of one thing, not a million things, just one thing that you need the Lord to forgive you for. Let's listen to the first lesson. Divine answer.
Survive without you knowing how to practice and how to ask for appropriately forgiveness. No society can hold together. It has no future unless the people in that society learn how to forgive one another. And in our own lives, we'll be friendless unless we learn how to both give and receive forgiveness. There are six words you need to know in order to be successful in life. Two three-word phrases. The first is, I am sorry. No successful person became successful without knowing how to say that. And the other three, I forgive you. I am sorry and I forgive you. These words need to not only spring from your lips with some regularity, but they need to be experienced in your heart in order for you to find the life that God intends for you to have. Now, this week I was reading about forgiveness and studying forgiveness. And then I went online and I began looking at how people ask for forgiveness. And there are several websites where you can go and you can actually make a public apology for the things that you've done wrong, which is kind of interesting, you know, that you would post your apology online, and some of these are anonymous, which is sort of interesting because ideally you're actually apologizing to the person you wronged, but in some cases the people who post on these websites are doing so because they can't find the people that they wronged. Maybe this happened a long time ago, or they don't know how to get in contact with them. Sometimes I think they're just practicing in putting something down on the internet that they hope to be able to say to individuals at some point in the future. So I was on one of these particular sites called thepublicapology.com, and I read these apologies. It's sort of like reading somebody's diary. To all of the customers of the local florist who got sneezing powder in their flowers last Tuesday, I apologize. You were really not the intended victims. I just wanted to make you angry at the florist, my stingy employer. I wasn't trying to hurt you, Jed. I'm pretty sure Jed doesn't work at that florist anymore. Okay, here's another one. I'm sorry, you were waiting for the car to get out of the parking place so you could back in, and I slid in frontward. I had to do this because I was desperate to get into the store so I could use the men's room, and there were no other spaces. My apologies. I hope you read this and understand. Signed, driver of gray Honda. Oh, this one. To all my high school classmates, I'm so sorry for the mornings when I came to school without brushing my teeth. I don't know where I got the idea that if I didn't eat, I didn't need to brush. I know you tried to hit, but I didn't get it. I am really sorry. Now, those are all kind of funny, but there are some really serious ones on this website as well, like this one. For all the things that happened to you as a kid that I never knew about, maybe you were told not to tell me, but I should have been there for you, and you should have been able to tell me anything. For the fact that you weren't, and I wasn't, I'm truly sorry, Mom. Psalm 32 is one of seven penitential psalms in the book of Psalms. There's seven of these that are prayers of confession in which this psalmist is crying out to God to be delivered from the guilt and the shame that they feel as a result of their estrangement from God. So we read in Psalm 32, day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Or Psalm 38, my guilt has overwhelmed me like a burden too heavy to bear. That's a powerful metaphor. This idea of a burden too heavy to bear is what it feels like when we're aware of our sin and we feel estranged from God, the very source of our lives. I shared this metaphor in a very tangible way with you a couple of years ago, but I thought it appropriate to repeat it today. This idea that when we sin and we don't ask for forgiveness, and here I'm speaking specifically in our relationship with God, we'll talk about our other relationships in the next few weeks, but when we sin and we find ourselves estranged from God and we don't seek forgiveness, then we just carry that sin around with us. You know, and some of those sins are the kind of hurts that we inflict on others, and it takes weeks perhaps to heal those if we ever come to our senses and ask for forgiveness. But sometimes we don't, and we just stay estranged from them, and in the process, estranged from God, who is their Heavenly Father. Sometimes they're small things. I mean, like, every day, it's the person you cut off as you're driving too fast and in a hurry to get up there at the front of the intersection and make it through. Or it's the word that you said about somebody you thought was funny, but they walked away wounded. It's all of those little white lies that we've told and the deceptions that we've held out. All of these things, and we pile them in our pack. We sometimes don't even realize what we've done, and sometimes by the look on the faces of others, we can see that we hurt them, or that we were supposed to reach out and do something to care, and we were just too busy, but we didn't really care. Sometimes the weight of them is much heavier than that. And sometimes the things that we do that if somebody found out, we could lose our job, or our position, or our status in the community, if anybody actually knew we were doing these things. And some of them, so heavy. I mean, if our spouse found out, our family might fall apart. If the law found out, we might be in jail. And without asking for forgiveness, without true repentance, without remorse and moving towards healing, what we do is we decide we're just going to carry these things around with us. Just carry them with us. You know, and we don't even notice sometimes because we carry one and it feels a little heavy, but we don't really notice. We add another one, we add another one. What we can't see is that we're hunched over after a while. We don't have the spring in our step anymore. We don't have the joy that we once had. We can't sing and dance and shout because we have this heaviness in our hearts, this growing sense of alienation and estrangement from other people and from God. And we just keep carrying it. Day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. My guilt has overwhelmed me like a burden too heavy to carry. Now the good news that the scriptures have to teach us is that God is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. The Christian faith, more than any other world religion I'm aware of, has this dominant theme, this idea that God wants to forgive you, that God wants to lighten your load, that God is longing to bring you back to the path. You don't have to pay any price. You don't have to do anything because the price was paid for you. What you have to do is turn and acknowledge or recognize where you've strayed from the path, to feel the weight of that here, and then to give that to God and say, God, I'm sorry for what I've done. I don't want to be that anymore. We call that repentance. Repentance is to see the wrong that you've done, to recognize where you are supposed to be and where you are, and to see the cost of that. In the case of our faith, the cost of that was Jesus Christ. The cost of that is the wounds to other people and the estrangement from God, to see the cost and then to cry out, God, I'm sorry. I don't want to be that anymore. Please forgive me and heal me. Last week I asked people on my Facebook page, I said, how do you struggle with forgiveness? One woman wrote, I cannot even forgive myself, so it's hard for me to believe that God can forgive me. It's like he's handing salvation, grace, and forgiveness to me in a beautifully wrapped present, and he's asking me to take the present for him. I've never been able to take his gift. As I feel so down on myself, I know it's sad, especially for me and for God. Another wrote, I struggle almost daily. I can see how God works in others' lives, but in my own, I struggle. I know that God loves me no matter what I've done or been in my life, but to really feel it at the core of my being, I struggle. One of our members who served in the military wrote, "In the military, I took people's lives. I spent years filled with guilt because of this. Having been in close combat situations where you're looking at a person while taking their life changes you. It was impossible to imagine God forgiving me for something that I could not forgive myself for doing." Here's the thing. What you're doing is you know you need it, and you're carrying around all this baggage of burden that's too heavy for you to carry. And God keeps crying out to you, "Let me have it. Let me have your burden. Don't you see it? I already paid the price for it on the cross. Let me have it." And the way it's supposed to work is you repent and you express your sorrow to God. And you turn towards him. And he welcomes you back. And he takes that burden and allows you to let it go. I feel like I can fly. And that's how you feel when you finally let it go. You feel grace. This is what the psalmist said when he said, "Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin." And that's why the psalmist could say in our passage, "Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered." In Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34, God says this to the prophet. He says, "In the last days, I will make a new covenant with my people Israel." You recognize that phrase, new covenant? This is my blood of the new covenant. "In the last days, I will make a new covenant with my people Israel. I will teach them to know the Lord from the least to the greatest. I will write my law in their hearts." Listen, "and I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more." God doesn't forget our sin. He chooses not to remember it. And he invites you to let it go. God is a God of extravagant mercy, and he longs to forgive you, to heal you, and to put you back in right relationship with him.
This is the third time in my ministry that I've offered this series from Reverend Adam Hamilton. Now, I could have taken the chapter from his book and rewrote it and spoke it. I can do that. But he presents it, I think, in a way that everybody can hear and understand and participate with and help us to change our own lives so that we can imitate Christ in our daily living. I hope that you'll agree and enjoy hearing from Reverend Adam Hamilton. This is an old series. It's been around a long time. I told somebody, if you see Reverend Hamilton today, he's really aged a lot, haven't we all? Remember, your pastors are carrying a lot of burdens. They've taken a toll on their lives. When we don't seek forgiveness, it takes a toll on our lives. It is like we are carrying around those rocks, that they're bending our hearts so that we can't even look up to praise God. That's what we're created for. We're created to praise and glorify God. when we allow the hurts that we have committed to go unforgiven, we're burdened with that. And when we allow the hurts that have been inflicted upon us to remain, that's that heavy, heavy weight. It pulls us downward instead of allowing us to rise up. So today, we look at asking forgiveness for the things we ourselves have done. I know that there are buckets of them in each of our lives, backpacks full of those rocks. But all I ask today is for you to pick one. Just pick one thing that you've fallen short on, that you know you can do a better job of. None of them are inconsequential. They may start out as that little pebble, that little stone, the little rock. But when we don't seek forgiveness, somehow those pebbles become stones, and stones become boulders. This is one of God's ways that He allows us to be in relationship with Him and with each other. So in your heart of hearts today, think of just that one thing that you want to seek forgiveness for. We'll do that at the end of the service today.
Thankfully, God does not give us what we deserve. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His loving kindness towards those who fear Him. Psalms 103, verses 10 and 11. The Bible makes it clear that God's loving kindness towards us is far greater than our comprehension of it. Isn't it encouraging to know, knowing that because of His loving kindness, God does not give us what we deserve? As the psalmist states, He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. On the flip side of that same coin, we quickly realize that we couldn't possibly give God what He deserves. If I gave absolutely everything I own and all I'll ever have and be, it would be no price to pay for God's loving kindness towards me. Giving today as generously and as gratefully as you possibly can, knowing that we can never give God what He truly deserves, and thankfully, He's given us so much more than our iniquities have earned. We are always grateful for each gift of time, talent, and treasure. Your gifts in person and online make ministry possible. Our ushers would come forward to the offering.
Thank you.
Restorer of divided hearts, bless our gifts this morning. Make our offering a path to holy living in action. May our very lives reflect the truth of our faith and our commitment to your world. With generous hearts, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Remain standing for our hymn of dedication. This is going to be our hymn of the month, or hymn of the sermon series, Grace Alone. It's in the hymn that we sing on page 2162. I'm going to have Christy play through it once, and then we'll sing. Trespasses. We're going to stop just for a few seconds. and lift to the Lord that one thing that you want to work on today. Forgiveness for yourself. Then we'll go on, we'll move on, and then we'll sing it, say it a second time all the way through. But I hope you're still thinking about God's forgiveness and our trespasses. Pray the Lord's Prayer with me. Again, we'll stop just for a second when we get to forgive us our trespasses. Let's pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses. As we forgive those who